Hi, I'm Chet Haas, an engineer on the Android team at Google. I work on graphics and animations, and today I want to talk about the new animation system that came on in the 3.0 release. Specifically, I want to talk about ObjectAnimator and its ability to animate view properties. So let's take a look at a demo, which looks remarkably similar to a demo we saw in a previous episode where we were talking about view animations. So the point of today's demo is to show basically how to do similar kinds of things with the new animation system as you could do with the old animation system. So we have some very boring buttons on the screen with names of animations that are going to run on the buttons as we click on them. So we have an alpha animation that fades the button in and out, translate moves the button around, rotate spins it around, scale, and then set runs the animations in sequence. Now, one thing to note about this demo versus the view animation demo is that you can use the choreography class called animator set to actually run different animations on different objects. It's easier to choreograph a more complex animations where this animator set is actually running animations on several different objects, not just on the same button down there. Regardless, they're kind of ugly animations. This is not what you'd want in your application. This is a little bit more of about the technique of creating and running these animations. Also, just as in the previous demo where we saw view animations created from resources, you can also create Object Animator animations from resources as well. So we check the little box and we can load and run the animations that are then created from resources instead. On this one, the animation resource is actually running on the same button, so we get that really egregious effect of running the animations in sequence on that single button. Okay, demo, not terribly interesting. Code, a little more interesting. So let's take a look at the code. So we have this class called Property Animations. We have the checkbox that controls whether we're going to be loading from resources or loading from code. We have the buttons that we create here, or load in from the resource, the layout resource, and then we have the animations that we create on the fly. So this is sort of the general way of how you create object animators to animate specific properties on views. Let me bring this code a little bit more in line so you can actually see it on the screen. So we have an alpha animation. This is created by saying, okay, I want a floating point animation. There are all these factory methods on object animator as well as value animator to create and then return one of these animator objects. So we're going to say object animator.ofFloat, and the target of the animation is going to be the alpha button that we found by ID above. And we're going to animate the property view.alpha. Now, there's different ways to do this. The original way in 3.0 was to actually use a string where you use a word that is then associated with setters and getters on the target object. So in this case, we could use the string alpha, and then it's going to use reflection or JNI to go in and look at that target object you provided and say, is there a set alpha that I can call during the animation? And optionally, it may also look for a get alpha to derive the original value that it starts from. But in, I think it was 3.1 or 3.2, we released a new property mechanism, which are these static objects on the view class itself. And they're slightly more efficient. So instead of using reflection or JNI to get to those setters and getters, we can simply call directly into a setter and getter directly in the property object. So slightly more efficient. I tend to prefer that when I'm animating view properties. So we've said, okay, I want to animate the alpha button. I want to animate the alpha property on that button, and I want to animate it to a value of 0. Note, I didn't tell it what value to start from. It's going to assume that it starts from whatever value it has right now. So it's going to go ahead and call the property object and say, what value do you have now? Now animate it to 0. It has a default duration, unlike the old animations, which didn't have a default duration. The new object animator animations have a default duration of 300 milliseconds, so we don't need to set that duration. We're going to set a repeat count of 1, which means we're going to run once and then repeat once after that, and a repeat mode or reverse, so it's going to fade out and then back in. Translate animation, similarly, we're going to create an object animator of float. We're going to target the translate button, and we're going to target the view translation X property and give it a value of 800. So this means it's going to start from wherever it happens to be right now, which I happen to know is 0 because I wrote the app, and it's going to animate to a value of 800. Repeat count of 1, a repeat mode of reverse, which means it's going to animate over to the right and then slide back over to the left. Rotate animation, you're probably getting the pattern by now. We say object animator.ofFloat of the target that we want to animate and the property on that target we want to animate. We're going to animate from its current value, which happens to be 0, to a value of 360. So it's simply going to spin a full loop. And by default, it's going to rotate around its center. And you can set the pivot point for scale and rotation animations if you want. Repeat count of one, repeat mode reverse, so it's going to spin, and then it's going to spin back. And then we have a slightly more complex one for scaling, because we're going to animate two properties at the same time, the scale x as well as the scale y. So we use this other class called property values holder and say, I'm going to want a property values holder of float, and we're going to target these properties on the object. And we're going to scale up from whatever it happens to be, starts with the default value of one, up to a value of two. Then we create a scale animation, and instead of being of float, we're going to say of property values holder. That's the target object. These are the property value holder objects that we're going to use. And again, we're going to repeat and reverse. Finally, the set animation. This uses the animator set class, which provides an easy way for you to have more interesting choreography of multiple animations that can be staggered in time or run together, run sequentially. Lots of different ways to use this. One of the things you'll notice is that there's this Fluent API where you can say, I want to play the translation animation, and I want to play that after the alpha animation, but before the rotation animation, sort of build up these complex chains. And then you start the animation, it figures out the tree, the graph of how these things interrelate, and then it executes all of them in the order that you specified. Then we call the setup animation, which says, okay, here's the objects that we created above, and alternately, here's the resource IDs if you want to run it from the resource instead. So we go into that method where we set up and run the animation, and if the checkbox is checked, then we need to load the resource first. And this is something to be aware of if you are going to use animator resources. They don't have a concept of instances in the resources. So after you load the resource and you have your animator object, then you need to set a target on it so that it knows what target you're actually trying to animate. So we're going to set the target, and then we start the animation. Alternatively, if we're not launching from the resource, if we're not creating from the resource, if we're instead creating from the codes that we had above for creating the animations, then we simply call start on that. Let's take a look at some of the resources for how we create these things. We have an object animator tag, and we pass in property names, which should make sense. They were sort of created that way. So we have a property name, we're going to animate alpha, we're going to repeat it once and reverse it, duration of 300 milliseconds, and a value to zero. So it's simply going to fade out, and then since it's reversing, it's going to fade back in. We have a move animation, again, similar to what we saw in code. Scale animation, this one is the one that actually has two properties that are being animated in parallel. Instead of using property values holder, I happen to be using an animator set here, where we create two object animators on the different scale x and scale y properties. Spin is going to do a rotation animation. And then finally, this combo file is an animator set, which is going to run all of these sequentially. And it's going to run it all on the same target object there. So this is the new property animation system. So if you're running code from 3.0 onwards, it's a more robust animation system where you can target these view properties as well as any arbitrary target and arbitrary property. And we'll see some of that in future episodes. Thanks.